let us look at, I don't want to have images. I'm not really interested in images. What I want to give is, I want to give environment to the team, right? So for example, your team is developing a Java application or a .NET application, right? And you want to give basically something like URL to your testing team. You don't want to give them saying that, take this image, create a machine. You don't want to do all of that. You want to just say that, I want to give you a URL. The URL will be accessed by your testing team. They will be seeing the application and they will be logging in, right? They are not worried whether you create an image. They are not worried what you do and all of that. So what they want is, they want an environment with your application running in there, okay? So what was the difference when we compared this with Packer? Can we do that same thing with Packer? No. From Packer, we can create an AMI. That's it. But what I am asking is, I want you to give me a URL of the instance. Instance is a server, right? So for example, whenever I deploy the application, I want to give something like http://, whatever the public IP address of this machine is. Let us assume that, this is a public IP address. :8080/gol, game of life. I have to give this to my testing team, right? I want to give the executing or running environments. How do I do that? Okay. Now, for this, there are many tools. Right? So for example, I can directly use, let us assume that I already have a system. Whose public IP address is 12.12.12.12. This is one scenario, right? I already have a system whose public IP address is this, right? The other thing is, I don't have any system and I want to give a URL to the team. I don't have any system and I want to give a URL to the team. The only thing which I know is, okay, how to deploy application and where to deploy application. Okay. When I say where, I'm not telling about a machine, I'm telling about the environment. Is it in AWS? Is it in Azure? Is it in your company in some VM? That is what you know, all right? But in the above case, you already have a system. The only thing which you need to do is, you need to deploy your system. To be very specific, for me here, provisioning is enough. Yes or no? For whatever we have been learning for the last 2 weeks, if I have to take the earlier scenario, if I just have the provisioning script, I can make the first one available. Yes or no? I already have a system. I have to log in into my system and execute the provisioning script. For the people who know Ansible, they can execute Ansible. For the people who know Shell, they can execute Shell or whatever it is. For the first case, just provisioning is enough. But for the second case, I need to create infrastructure in whatever region it is, and then I need to do provision. Yes or no? Yes. So I need to create infra and then do provision. So can I write this as create infra and execute provision? And there are many tools to do that. For example, if my infra is AWS, okay, for creating the infra, I can use something called as CloudFormation. If my infra is Azure, I can use something called as ARM. So there are already some tools which can do this job for you, right? And apart from this, tools like Chef or Ansible also have some extensions. In the case of Chef, we call that as supermarket cookbooks. In the case of Ansible, we call them as Galaxy roles, right? Where they can create the infrastructure. But remember, they are not meant for that, right? They are not meant for that, but they can do this job. People don't like this approach, right? Ansible is meant for doing something else. Ansible is just for provisioning, not for creating infra. Chef is also for that. Okay, is it possible? Yes, it is possible. But is it a better way? No. That's the whole point, right? So even for creating this cloud formation or ARM, there is no need for you to do all of this. You can go with CLI options also. Azure has a CLI, AWS has a CLI, and you can create infrastructure with CLI. But we want something which is more intuitive, right? So for that, what we want is, how do you like your this creation code to be? Creation code, when I'm saying, I'm speaking about creating infrastructure, right? Okay. First thing is, if I ask, do you want it to be simple or complex? The obvious answer will be simple itself. I'm not worried about that. I'm not worried about the simplicity or complexity of it. The thing which I'm worried is, today I'm creating infrastructure in one case, in one scenario. Tomorrow I might be doing in some other scenario. So from one scenario to other scenario, do you like too many changes? No, right? So same way of creation for different environments, right? And whenever I'm saying different environments, I mean different okay, so for example, your architecture is this. Your company has said that, okay, we have an application, and then for that application, we are using two clouds. This is basically AWS, and this is Azure. In Azure, I would like to have my database because SQL Server is very strong in Azure. Right, whereas my web server, I want it into AWS. So your Apache server is in AWS, or your middleware Tomcat server is in AWS, and your database is in Azure. So these kind of things become complicated. Yeah, even though it is not used by many organizations, there are some organizations who are already doing it, right? You can not only think about one cloud provider, you can think about hybrid kind of model where you have some infra in one environment and some infra in other environment, right? This is especially valid for hybrid cloud scenarios. So let us forget about this case. Your company has chosen that I'll be using AWS itself. I'm using AWS itself, but the database. It will be in my office, which I call as on-premise, right? The database is in my office in some virtual machine, VMware. So your database is in VMware. Rest of the stuff is in AWS. Okay, and every time you have to create this. Every time you have to create this. Is it simple job? No, it is not simple. So since it is not simple, what they ask to do is, can you develop some script which does this so that I can reuse it too many times? Yeah, we can do that. For that, you can start writing shell script or PowerShell script or whatever it is. Good, things will work out. It is not that shell script cannot do this or PowerShell script cannot do this. The problem is, tomorrow whenever you have to change the script, it would be too much difficult. So the whole point of existence of Terraform is, if you want to create infrastructure and do provisioning, I would say that go with this model, infrastructure as a code, right? IAC. And I will give you a special language or a special syntax. You have to write in that, right? Changes will become simple to handle. So for example, now What happens is your VMware is upgraded from previous version to the new version, right? And there are some changes in the shell scripting. Now, what you have to do is you have to change your whole shell script. But if you're using tools like this, you need not worry about that. That is something which Terraform does for you. At a max, you might need to upgrade Terraform. At a max, you might need to upgrade Terraform and make changes, very slight changes, that's it. And sometimes it might go away with no changes at all. All right, that's the whole point. Now, AWS, you have been creating the stuff in US region. Now I want the same infra to be in India. All right, it is a very simple change, but shell script, it might not be as simple as what we think about it. So the whole point of doing this kind of infrastructures is we want this stuff to be created in a very simple way. That's where IAC comes into play. Terraform is the only tool which can work with multiple cloud providers, right? Remember in Packer, we have something called as builders. What were builders? Builder used to tell us, where do you want to create this image, right? And then we have provisioners, right? Here also we'll have the same thing. But the only difference is in Packer, we were creating image. Here we will be giving live environments. Like Packer, Terraform also has provisioning, where you can do shell provisioning, Ansible provisioning. You can do all sorts of different things. But Terraform is an infra provisioning tool. It can create infra and it can do provisioning for you. So that if you use just Terraform, that might be enough for you to deploy your live environments, right? But in Terraform, you can internally use, you might internally use Ansible, you might internally use Chef, you might internally use Docker or whatever it is. But the whole point is, for your deployment activities, Terraform might be enough. When we are speaking about virtual environments, any kind of virtual, let it be VMware, let it be cloud, right? Any kind of cloud, this could be enough. Am I clear with this? So with Terraform, what is that we get? We get live environments, environments which are executing. With Packer, we used to just get an image ID. Here we get a machine. Now, what we'll do is, let us try to see. Use case with Terraform, not Packer. Then we'll discuss about the Packer aspect of it, right? So this is your team. You have three teams. And they are developing, e-commerce application. One is a middleware team. The other one is a UI team. The third one could be a database kind of team, all right? So apart from that, you have two important teams over here. One is sales, the second one is QA. As per your company's role, daily, whatever your three teams, dev teams are doing, that activity has to be given out for testing, right? So the three teams which I have written on the top are doing developmental activities and they will be committing code, yes or no. They will be doing some work, right? Once they do their work throughout the day, right? And they would basically submit that code into some kind of version control system. Let us assume it is Git. So let us make that assumption also. So by 9 p.m., I'm not writing time zone, any time zone. So you have to generate application package. When I say application package, the package that is used to deploy your application, you have to create that, right? And then you would basically do some sort of testing and all of that activity, automated activity. And daily morning by 5 o'clock, you have to give a URL to the testing team. Or probably by whatever time, let me tell that by 10, you have to give this URL. So how do you do that? So Basically, all the three people's work will be in version control system. Let us not worry about it. It will be there in version control system. At 9 o'clock, you will be starting to do some activity. How do we trigger that? It is triggered somehow. We are not worried about it. Who triggers this? Not worried. But at 9 o'clock, what is it we are supposed to do? Every day, we are supposed to give a new environment. We should not be giving the old environment. We should be giving the new environment every day. So we are creating new machines every day. We are creating new machines every day. Fine. So when I say new machines every day, so the steps are something like this. Create 3 AWS EC2 machines, whatever it is. I'm just writing the steps. All right. And then create a DB in AWS RDS. Login into 3 AWS machines and install Tomcat, right? And copy var file like how we have done in the last class, game of life. They have some var file and they have to copy that. And then basically give the URL to testing. That's it. These are the four steps. I'm not written very detailed stuff. This is what you are supposed to do every day. So create a three machines or n number of machines and then log in into every machine and execute some script. Execute some script. So if you are from cloud backgrounds, basically we might also speak about load balancers and all of that stuff there, but it's okay. If you have three is confusing, just put it as one machine. This is what I'm supposed to do. Okay. So what I do is, one way is I can write a script, but as I said, script has its own disadvantages. So what I would be writing is I'd be writing a Terraform, right? Provisioning. And daily night at 9 o'clock, I'll just call this Terraform. I'll call it as Terraform script for now. I'll call Terraform script. Terraform script has some functionalities. One is you don't need to do too much of hard work. One is you don't need to do too much of hard work because Terraform is already aware of what AWS is, what Azure is, what VM is. So we'll be telling this to Terraform. And Terraform does the work for us. Am I clear with this? Right? So is this use case clear? Yeah, this is what you're going to write in your resume, by the way. I'm not telling the same use case, similar use case. Right? Okay. Now let us just have a look at Terraform script without having a knowledge of Terraform. Let us not even think of that. I'll just go to the A square zone and I'll open Terraform. Okay. Where is Hello World? Yeah, this is enough. Now this is Terraform script, by the way. Looking difficult, right? In Packer, what is it we used to write? Builder, variables. Variables are for the same purpose. So forget about variables. I'm not interested in variables. Come down. And then you have something called as builders. Right? So over here we have something called as provider. Builder will tell where to create an image. Provider will tell where to create the infrastructure. Provider will tell where to create the infrastructure. And then we are seeing one more thing which is called as resource. Resource will tell what is that you want to create. Do you want to create a EC2 machine? Do you want to create a database? Do you want to create a network? Do you want to create a load balancer? Anything which you want to create in Terraform is always a resource. So for example, if you see over here, he is creating something called as AWS instance. So he's creating an EC2 machine over there, right? For every resource, you will have provisioning. Okay. So without having much knowledge, we'll be doing all of this. We'll be understanding all of this, but just have a look at it. There we used to write about builder. Here we are writing something about provider, right? Builder and provider in somehow are related, because builder will tell where do I want to create a Packer image, and here basically the provider will tell me where is that you want to create the infrastructure, right? That is the first thing. And then what is that you want to create? Do you want to create? I said that, right? We wanted three EC2 machines. That means three resources, right? One database, one more resource. That is what you write. And then I said at the last that I want to give the URL to my testing team. Yes, scroll down. Are you seeing something called as output? Are you seeing something called as output? We will learn how to write things over here. But the whole point is we'll break our work into what is the provider, what are the resources which I want, right? And to create any resource, is it normal or do I need to do any sort of provisioning? And then what is that I should display as output? That's it. And Terraform is not a specific structure like JSON. They have their own way of telling it, right? Terraform is written in its own way. But by the way, it is not programming language. It is much like your JSON, but they have their own format. This is called as DSL, domain specific language, right? So DSL means that whenever you are working on a tool and tool specifies you to do the things in some way, right, which is non-standard, that is called as DSL. In the case of Packer, they have said standard notation, use JSON. But in the case of Terraform, what they have said is there is no standard. You have to write something which I can understand. That is DSL. Terraform has its own DSL. Now, in Terraform, whenever you are writing, what is it we would write about? We would worry about, given whatever the work, the first thing which I need to do is, where do I need to create these resources? In AWS. Or in Azure or in VM. This helps me in finding out a detail, very important detail, which is called as simple, right? And the next thing is, yeah, in this infra, what is that you want to create? I want to create a virtual machine. I want to create a network. I want to create something, whatever it is. Everything which you want to create will become a, right? Okay. Now, what is that you want to display to the user? That will become output, right? Apart from that, you would have much like, okay. So there is one more thing over here, which is called as data sources. I'm not getting into it right now. We'll discuss it once we know something about Terraform. But there is one more thing over here, which is called as data source. For me now to define a data source, it will be slightly difficult, because we have not even written one Terraform script. Once we write, it would be easier. So are we clear about it? In Terraform, what is that we worry about? We worry about provider, we worry about resources, we worry about output. And if you don't want to hard code Terraform, you would be using variables, right? Usage of variables in any language is for the same purpose. You don't want to hard code. Let it be Terraform or let it be whatever we do. Even in Ansible, the same thing appears. Even in Chef, the same thing appears. So whenever you don't want to write a script which works only for one scenario, you would parameterize. Then the concept of variable or parameter comes into play. Am I clear with this? Right? Any questions in this? Before we do what a Terraform is, how do I install Terraform and all of that? Now let us go to the Terraform. I want to install Terraform in my system. By now we could know of it. Terraform is also from the same organization which has created Vagrant, which has created Packer, HashiCorp. So Terraform. Okay. So are you seeing download? Yes, you can download and install. I'm not sure whether I have Terraform on this machine or not. I don't have it. Good. So one thing is I can click on download. The same way how I installed Packer, I can download and install it, but no. So Choco Terraform. This is the latest version, right? 11.8 is what we are seeing over there. And now I'll be just saying Choco install Terraform. So Choco install Terraform minus For Terraform, we need only same things as what Packer is. Install Terraform, install respective CLIs. If your provider is AWS, have a AWS CLI. If your provider is Azure, have a Azure CLI. So I'm relaunching this. Terraform --. Watch. Yes. So we have Terraform. We'll look into commands. After this, we need to do one more thing. So let me go ahead. Create a folder. I am not submitting the same examples over there because in A Square Zone we have a lot of examples, right? But if you still need them, just ask me. I'll just upload them, right? I'll commit them. I don't see any need because we already have some examples over there. Oh, fine. And over here, let me create a new folder, and my example is okay. September 2018. It's okay. Hello Terraform. All right. Okay. So let me open Visual Studio Code over here. Okay. And go to extensions, the fourth stuff over here, and install Terraform extension. So there are many examples over here. For example, if you are working on autocomplete, there is Azure Terraform and all of that. We'll go into that stuff later, but let us go into stuff which is at the top right now. This will help you out. That's it. It is no big deal. It is whenever you are writing Terraform, it will help you saying that, okay, you have written the right syntax, or it will just give you some coloring, nothing more than that, right? So just reload after this. You have some stuff. Now go ahead and create a new file called as, okay, let me call it as main.tf. Terraform files, you should always write with an extension of tf. Okay. Now I want to write about provider. It gives me very little help over here. So I want to write about a resource. So it will give me very simple help around it, right? Fine. Okay. But if you go with autocomplete or those kind of extensions, it might look good. But as of now, that is enough for us. Let us not think too much about it. So whenever we are writing a Terraform file, like Packer, always go through the documentation. Okay. Like Packer, always go through documentation of it. And what is the first thing which we want? We want a provider. So let me get into the providers. And then we have a hell lot of providers. We have a whole list of providers. So if your company is working on VMware, there are VMware providers also. Don't do the work manually. Try to go with Terraform, and Terraform is a free software anyway. Right? You have an enterprise product, but it's okay. Now, what is that I want? I want a. So then he says that whenever you're using provider, you're supposed to use this. You're supposed to tell that the provider is AWS. You're supposed to give me what is an access key, what is a secret key, and what is a region. We have done this in Terraform, in Packer also. So I'll be doing the same thing. So my provider over here is AWS, and see the syntaxes. You need to be very specific about it. Access key, access underscore key equals to whatever your access key is, right? And there is no comma. You have to go to the next line. Secret underscore key, and then region. Can we get this? So go to the IAM, create a user, you will get a secret key and access key, and you copy and paste them over here. We know this. we have been through this, right? Once you have done with the provider, right, in the provider, okay, scroll down, you'll be seeing something called as resources. It will be a huge list. You have to do a scroll down. There is no way around it. But are you seeing resources? Yes. So I want to create an EC2 machine. Okay. Are you seeing EC2 resources? Right. And EC2 machine, what is it we call it? Instance. Okay. Now look into this resource. What is the resource name which you have selected? AWS underscore instance. And then you are telling what is your image name. We'll come back to this notations. Don't worry about it. We are telling what is the name, what is the instance type. What is the instance type? And this the third section after this is the name which you want to call it. The name which you want to call it. So whenever you are writing a resource, are you seeing type? Type is something which you have to search in Terraform. Name is something which you call it. So for example, I am creating this EC2 machine for Apache server. So what I'm creating? AWS instance. So for AWS instance, what is the type? He's telling that the type is AWS underscore instance. So type, I'll replace it with AWS underscore instance. And name is your choice. You call it whatever you want. I'm calling it as simple. Yes. And for every resource, you will have arguments which you can pass. What is the AMID which you want? What is the availability zone which you want? You will have a whole list of things. You'll have whole list of things. And you can basically select them based out of what is that you want. What is it you want? Let us basically select the very simple details out of it. Right? I want the AMI type and I want the instance type. That's it. So I'll select saying that I'm interested in providing an AMI. Okay. Whatever the AMI is. And then instance underscore type. Can you fill in all of these values? We know how to basically get an access key, secret key, and a region. And we know how to pass the AMI ID and how to pass the instance ID. And then you will have certain basic Terraform commands. Terraform commands. So what are the Terraform commands that are available for us? Let us just have a look at it. Terraform. So you have something called as Terraform apply, Terraform console, Terraform destroy, env format, all different stuffs, right? And but at the last we are seeing something called as validate, right? And then we are seeing something called as plan, what are the providers and all of that. So what we'll do is we'll execute two commands for now. One is Terraform validate, the other one is basically Terraform apply. Terraform apply creates or builds your infrastructure. Terraform destroy will remove your infrastructure. And Terraform validate, we know what Packer validate has done. It will tell whatever you have written is right or wrong. Now, let me just copy these values. So I'll go to the AWS. First is, let me get into IAM. I want a secret key and access key, right? First. Let me get into my user. I'm using the same Packer user. If you want, you can create a new user for this, right? Security credentials. I don't have any access key. I'm just saying that I want to create an access key. So this is my access key. And this is my secret key. And US simple, right? Now let me just go to the EC2 machine. Okay, You can tell whatever image which you want to create. Okay. Let us assume that I want to use an image which I have basically built from Packer or anything for that matter. I just want an image ID. I'm just copying this image ID. And then I would say that this is the image which I want to create. And my instance type is whatever the instance type is. And most of our practice samples will be using T2 dot. I don't have any output. I don't have any. So I have written a very basic file with a provider and a resource. So I'm trying to create a EC2 machine with some image. That's it. Right? Remember, I have not passed security group. There is no security group which I have passed. I am not told what is the key value pair. Generally, while creating the EC2 machine, you have to tell what is the key pair which you select. Right? So I have not passed all of them. It is a very default stuff. So what I do is I'd get into this folder. So what is this folder? CD. Hello. In Packer, whenever we were running commands, we were passing files, right? Packer, validate, hello.json, right? Or whatever it is. In Terraform, you don't pass file, you pass a directory. In Terraform, the only difference is, in Packer, you used to say that Packer validate file's name. Here, you have to say Terraform validate and folder's name. That is the only difference. So now let me do that. Terraform validate. And I have to give the folder's name. I'm already in the current directory. I'm already in the same directory. I'm saying that validate the same directory which I'm already in. So it is saying that, okay. You are telling this, but I don't know what your AWS provider is. I don't know what your AWS provider is. Okay, good. Now let us go into Terraform command again. Are you seeing anything called as init? So that is the first thing which you always need to execute. If you do that Terraform init, what Terraform does is it will look into your file and it will see what are the providers that are available. And it will ensure that those providers are available in your system and downloaded into subsequent folder structure. So the first command which I always should execute is Terraform init. Okay. And I don't know how to execute this. I can just do help or whatever it is, or basically just go ahead and do it. So are you seeing, since we in our file there is a provider which is called as AWS and it is downloading a provider AWS. Now let me execute the same command again. Terraform validate, then it doesn't give me any error. So if you are not getting anything, it is as good as everything is fine. It is as good as everything is fine. Now I would say Terraform apply. Let us look at what are the command line arguments which we can pass. So he's trying to tell that there is something called as auto approve and all of that stuff. You can use many different things. And let us look at the basic stuff. Terraform apply directory or plan. Since we don't know what a plan is yet, I'll be going with directory itself. So Terraform apply. And I'll give it out. Before this, let me just get into our folder. Hello Terraform. Are we seeing any new folder created? Dot Terraform. Your providers will be in this. So don't mess this folder. Right? Your providers will be in this. So if you get into dot Terraform and see what is there, you'll have this AWS provider. This AWS provider. Fine. Now I just say Terraform apply and is trying to tell that, okay, this is what would happen. So whenever you try to do this, the following things will happen. You are given me the value saying that your AMI ID is this. Okay. And once you scroll down, you'd be seeing the instance type also. Do you want to? Sorry, man. Do you want to add it? Okay. So if you want to just say one, it will add. Okay. So I'll be just saying one is whatever values which you are seeing in one is add. Then it is saying that Terraform will provide the following actions. If you want to continue, just type S. Do you want to continue with this? So I'll just say yes. The moment I say yes, I am giving approval to Terraform, then it would start creating something. Okay. Now let me go into my AWS instances. Okay. Are you seeing something in pending state? Right? Yeah, it might not have all the values. It might not have a decent security group. It might not have a, what do you say, machine size, all of that. We have not passed many things to it. We have just given very basic values to it. You might not be able to log in into this machine because you have not told what is a key value pair. Okay? So whatever you have done might not be a solution which you can use in the enterprise. But as a first stuff, that is more than enough. All right? So let us see what is happening. It is saying that apply is complete. Okay? The following resources are added and machine with following ID is added to you. Okay? So am I seeing the machine? Yes? Okay, good. Now I would say Terraform. I'll not even get into AWS. That's the whole point which I'm trying to tell. I'll be running all of this from the command lines of my machine, right? So then it will try to set the fit, saying that, okay, it might not be visible over here, but whatever you are seeing is minus symbol there. Minus is destroy. Do you want to continue with this? Yes, I would like to. Okay. Now let us see what is happening over here. Yes, so there is no need for you to get into AWS, create stuff, or get into Azure and create stuff. Write a Terraform script, execute it. If everything has happened correctly, you'll get the whole stuff, right? And whenever you want to delete it, there is no need for you to get into each and every resource and delete it. Basically, you just say Terraform destroy. That's the whole point, right? And this, if you call it from Jenkins, that becomes your continuous delivery or continuous deployment, right?